In this video, we'll be learning about screw gauge, functions of the different parts which make up the screw gauge. We'll be also learning about the principle on which the screw gauge is based upon. Then we'll be learning about the pitch and the least count, zero error and backlash error of a screw gauge, and finally how to take any reading from a screw gauge. So let's begin. So as you can see on the screen, I have a picture of a screw gauge. Now you can find screw gauges of different variations available, but the one I am using now is the one which is mostly used in ICSC schools. So this is the image of a screw gauge, okay? And what are the different parts you can see in the diagram labeled below. You have the final the image over here on the top and the diagram labeled below. The first thing which you should note is this part, which is called the screw, okay? This part. Now this part may be visible or maybe inside something, okay? So the screw is actually inside this. So this is the screw from where this particular apparatus has derived its name, okay? Now the next part to note is that it is having a scale. It is having a scale. This scale is called the main scale, which you can see in the image over here. This is the main scale, okay? The markings are there, okay? Next, you have the circular scale on top of the main scale. This is the circular scale which you find over here in the diagram, okay? Now these are all on top of each other, so this is a better view over here. You can see this is the screw. You can find this is the screw, okay? These are the threads of the screw, and in this particular case the screw is inside a cover. Okay, so this is the screw. Actually the screw is inside this, and then this part is the nut, okay, in which the screw goes. So when you rotate this particular screw it goes inside a nut, okay? So this is the nut. This part is the nut, okay? Now on top of this nut you have a sleeve. Now this is a sleeve on which there is a marking, which is called the linear scale or the main scale or the pitch scale, okay? This is also known as the main scale, okay? Now on top of that sleeve you will have a thimble. This is called a thimble, okay? On which you will have markings, and these are markings are known as the circular or the head scale, circular scale or the head scale, okay? Now moving on to the other parts. The screw is inside the cover, and that cover is also known as a spindle, okay? This you can call as a screw or a spindle. This part you can see in the original image, this part can be called as a screw or a spindle. Now this part which you find at the end is called a ratchet, and using this part only you rotate the screw. So if you rotate this in the clockwise direction, the ratchet, then the screw will move in the forward direction, okay? Now this part you can see is called the stud, okay? It is called the stud. The screw and the stud are similar to the jaws of the vernier caliper, okay? They are used to hold any object in between, so you can have any particular object in between, okay, over here. Also there is a U-shaped frame for holding the screw gauge actually properly. So these are the important parts of the screw gauge. Moving on to the principle of a screw, or the principle on which the screw gauge is based, is known as the principle of a screw. And what is it actually? So as you saw in the diagram, there was a screw and there were threads in between. So you can see these are threads, okay? These are threads. So the distance between the thread is known as a term called pitch, and that is a constant value for any particular screw gauge, okay? So when you rotate this screw gauge, suppose in the clockwise direction, the screw moves in the forward direction. For one complete rotation it moves a distance equal to the distance between the two threads, okay? So the gap between the two threads is the distance by which this particular screw gauge will move if it is rotated in one complete rotation. So what is actually the principle of a screw on rotating? On rotating, the head of a screw, it moves a linear distance equal to the distance between the two consecutive threads on it. So this is the principle of a screw. On rotating the head of a screw in one complete rotation, okay, in one complete rotation, it moves a linear distance equal to the distance between the two consecutive threads on it. So if you rotate this once, it will move in the forward direction. How much will it move? So if you rotate it one complete rotation, it will move the distance which is equal to the distance between the two consecutive threads. Now this is the principle of a screw. Now the distance, the linear distance which the screw moves when it is rotated in one complete rotation is called pitch. Okay, so we move on to the definition of a pitch. So the pitch of a screw gauge, or of a screw you can also write, is the linear distance moved by the screw in one complete rotation of its head. So this is the definition of a pitch. Now normally the screw gauge which we use in the practicals, in our practicals, in ICSC practicals or the ISC practicals, has a pitch of 1 millimeter, okay, but we can also have screw gauges of different pitch. Generally the pitch of a screw gauge is either 1 millimeter, this is the most common one, or 0.5 millimeter also, okay. So in order to find the pitch of a screw gauge, what you can do is, if the screw gauge is initially in this particular position, suppose you can see this is the zero mark, that is the screw gauge is actually at the 0 millimeter mark, and the 0th division is coinciding. 0th division here is coinciding. This is the 0th division coinciding. Now what you do is you rotate the screw once and bring back zero again. So you can see over here in the second diagram, I have again brought the zero mark coinciding with the main scale. And now I find is that this reading is now 1 mm. This is 1 mm. So earlier it was here, and when I rotated it for one complete rotation of the circular scale, this moved a distance of 1 millimeter. So this is actually the pitch of this particular screw gauge. What you can do is, instead of finding for one complete rotation, you can find it for two complete rotations or four complete rotations also. You repeat the same process. So what you will find, instead of making one complete rotation, you make two complete rotation, and you'll find that the reading comes out to 2 mm. So for two rotations, 2 mm is the distance moved. So for one rotation, it will be unitary method, it will be 1 millimeter. So this is the pitch, okay. So normally, ideally, we find it for four rotations. So we take it for four rotations and then divide the linear distance moved by the number of rotations. So normally it will come out to be 4 millimeter, and then we divide it by 4, the number of rotations we did, and that comes out to be 1 millimeter, okay. Now moving on to the least count, you can see this particular scale is the circular scale or the head scale, okay, circular or head scale, and it has 100 divisions in this particular case, has 100 divisions. It may also have 50 divisions or 500 divisions depending on the screw gauge we are using. The one which we use normally in the practical, physics practical lab, has 100 divisions, okay. So you can see this is the 90th division, then this is 95, and then 96, 7, 8, 9, and then this becomes the 100th division, okay. And if you make one complete rotation, we have seen that the linear distance moved is 1 mm, and that is called the pitch. So pitch is 1 mm. So we can say for 100 circular divisions, distance moved is 1 mm. So for 1 circular division, distance moved will be 1 by 100 millimeter, and this is nothing but the least count. So the least count of a screw is the distance moved by it in rotating the circular scale by 1 division. Okay, and as in earlier videos I have defined, the basic definition of a least count is the smallest measurement that particular instrument can take accurately. So if this is the least count of the screw gauge in this case, so we can say the smallest measurement which can be taken by this screw gauge is 1 by 100 mm, which comes out to be 0.01 mm. And if you remember, the least count of a meter scale was 1 mm. It was 1 mm. The least count of a vernier was 0.1 mm, and the least count of a screw gauge is 0.01 mm. So you can see the screw gauge can measure even smaller lengths than the vernier or a meter scale. So we can say precision of a screw gauge is better than that of a vernier or a meter scale. So as the least count decreases, accuracy increases. Okay, remember that. So you can see the least count is decreasing in this case, and the accuracy is increasing. So we can say the screw gauge is more accurate than that of a vernier caliper. So it can measure lengths up to 2 decimal places of a millimeter, or you can say this can be written in centimeter as 0.001 centimeter. So this can measure lengths up to an accuracy of 3 decimal places of a centimeter. Okay. So the general formula for the least count will become, for in case of a screw gauge, it will become least count equal to pitch upon total number of divisions on circular scale. Okay, so remember this particular formula, will be using this in case of a screw gauge. Now there are a few examples to note. If a screw moves, by 1 millimeter in two rotations, and total divisions in the circular scale is suppose 50, then what is the pitch first? The first thing which we need to find is pitch. Now we can see 1 millimeter moved in 2 rotations. So how much in 1 rotation? So that will be 0.5 millimeter. So what will be the least count? Least count will be 0.5 mm by number of divisions, which is 50. So it will come out to be 0.01 mm. Now if a screw moves, by 1 mm in 2 rotations and total divisions is 500 suppose, then again similarly pitch will be 0.5 mm, and least count in this case will be 0.5 mm by 500, and this will come out to be 0.001 mm. And if we write this in centimeter, this will become 0.0001 centimeter, 4 decimal places of a centimeter. And this is the example of a micrometer screw gauge. Micrometer screw gauge, okay? So if you are asked what is the least count of a micrometer screw gauge, then the least count of a micrometer screw gauge is 0.0001 centimeter. Why? Because this is actually equal to, since we have done units and measurement, 1 micrometer. 1 micrometer is, you know, 10 to the power minus 6 meter, or you can say 10 to the power minus 4 centimeter. Okay, so this is actually 10 to the power minus 4. So this is the least count of a micrometer screw gauge, and this has been asked in questions quite often, like what is the least count of a micrometer screw gauge. So remember, it is 1 micrometer or 10 to the power minus 4 centimeter. Now moving on to the concept of zero error. Now we had this zero error in vernier caliper also. So what is zero error in case of a screw gauge? The first thing is, you will have to close the screw gauge. That means you will have to make the stud and the screw meet each other. You don't place any object in between. When in this situation, what ideally should be is, this should be the case, that the main scale, this is the main scale, and the zero of the circular scale, they should be in line with each other. Okay, so this is called, suppose, the reference. Let us call this the reference line. Okay, the reference line of the main scale and the zero of the circular scale should be ideally in the same line, lying in the same line, coinciding with each other. Okay, ideally, in this case, the zero error will be nil. But if this does not happen, then this situation may arise, that the reference line is over here and the zero of the circular scale is, suppose, over here. So you can see now in this case, the zero error is there, and this is called the positive zero error. We'll deal with them separately, but this situation may arise, or this second situation may arise, where the reference line is here and the zero of the circular scale is above that line. Okay, is above that line. In the earlier example, it was below the line. In this case, it may be above the line. Okay, so in this case, it will be negative zero error. Now coming on to how to calculate the zero error. So if it is a positive zero error, what you need to do is, we are taking this example. So if zero of circular scale lies below the reference line of main scale, then zero error is positive. Okay, and how do you find the zero error? So you will see which division of the circular scale is now coinciding with the reference line. Zero is not coinciding, but which division is coinciding? So this is the division coinciding, we can see. And this is nothing but the 11th division. If you can see properly, it is the 11th division which is coinciding. So the zero error will be equal to, or first you write down, circular scale division coinciding is 11. Therefore, zero error will be equal to, you'll first give a positive sign because it is a positive zero error, then the division which is coinciding, into the least count. So in this case, it will become plus 11 into, if you write the least count in centimeter, so this comes out to be 0.011 centimeter. Okay, so this is the zero error, the plus or the positive zero error. Now if it is a negative zero error, if you take this particular case, now when will this happen? So if the zero of circular scale lies above the reference line of the main scale. Okay, so you can see this is the zero, the reference line, and the zero is lying above. Okay, then zero error is negative. So how do we find this? So first, again, you need to find the circular scale division coinciding. So if you can see, this is the division coinciding, and that is nothing but the 95th division. So we'll write 95. Then what you need to do is, like in case of vernier caliper for negative zero error, we did. In order to find zero error, you'll first put a negative sign, then you will subtract this division with the total number of division on the circular scale. So the total division in the circular scale in this case is 100, 100 minus 95, and then multiply this with the least count. Okay, so this comes out to be minus 5 into 0.001 centimeter, which is nothing but minus 0.005 centimeter. Okay, remember, so in case of positive zero error, we are just taking the division which is directly coinciding, multiplying it with the least count. In case of negative zero error, we are taking the division which is coinciding, subtracting it with the total number of division, and then multiplying it with the least count to get the zero error. And now, what is a backlash error? So what happens is, sometimes due to wear and tear, I'm writing this down first, sometimes due to constant use of wear and tear of threads of a screw. So if you're using it constantly, what happens is the threads of the screw or the nut may tear off, or the distance between them may increase. Okay, in such case, it is seen that on reversing the direction of rotation of the thimble, that means if you were rotating it in the clockwise direction, if you're rotating the screw gauge in the clockwise direction, and now if you try to rotate it in the anti-clockwise direction, what will happen is the tip of the screw does not start moving in the opposite direction at once. So you will feel a jerking motion. That means if you were rotating it in the clockwise direction and suddenly you rotate it in the anticlockwise, there will be no linear movement. So when you were rotating it in the clockwise direction, the screw was moving in the forward direction like this, and when you rotate it in the anti-clockwise direction, that means like this, what will happen is, instead of moving back, for a moment the screw will remain stuck at that one position only. So this will result in an error, and this error is known as a backlash error. So this results in error in measurement and is known as backlash error. So what you need to do is, you should ideally always rotate the screw in a single direction only. So if you were rotating it in the clockwise direction, keep on rotating it in the clockwise direction and not move it in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, moving on to taking readings from a screw gauge. So how do you take readings from a screw gauge? Now, normally we use screw gauge for taking readings of the diameter of a wire, or the thickness of a paper, or the thickness of any glass slab, so or the lead shots, the diameter of a lead shot. So you can see the images over here. In the first image, I have a wire. So in this case, we are measuring the diameter of a wire. So this is how you will hold the wire in between the stud and the screw. And similarly, here we are measuring the thickness of a glass slab. So this is how you will hold the slab in between the stud and the screw. Okay, once you have it in this position, what you will observe is there will be some linear distance moved in the main scale and some circular scale reading also. So we'll have to note down how much it has moved linearly in the main scale and how much in the circular scale. So let us take an example. Suppose after putting the wire or the glass slab, we have this particular readings in the main scale and the circular scale. So how do we take the reading? So first thing, the main scale reading you will take is main scale reading. What you will see is this part of the, you will see this part of the thimble, which particular reading of the main scale has this part crossed. Okay, so you can see in this particular case it has crossed 1 mm. This is 1 mm. Okay, on the main scale this has crossed 1 mm. This reading has been crossed. Okay, so you'll write main scale reading as 1 mm. If you're writing it in centimeter, you'll write it as 0.1 centimeter. Okay, next what you will find is circular scale division, which is coinciding. Okay, coinciding with the reference line. Now if you see in this case, what you will see is if it is not exactly coinciding, you'll see the division which it has just crossed. You can see this is the division we are talking of. This is the reference line, this is the reference line, and this division has to be crossed or is in line with the main scale. So what we need to do, this is the 31st division, so we'll write 31. Okay, and then we'll find the circular scale reading. Circular scale reading will be the circular scale division into the least count. Okay, so if you have taken this reading in centimeter, you'll take the least count in centimeter, so it will be 31 into 0.001 centimeter. This will come out to be 0.031 centimeter. Then what you need to do is, if there is any zero error in this particular screw gauge, you'll write the zero error value. If not, you'll write nil. Okay, and then the final reading, or the total reading will be the final reading. If it is the thickness of a glass slab, you'll write the thickness of the glass slab equal to, it will be MSR, which is main scale reading, plus CSR, which is circular scale reading, minus any zero error. So always we'll subtract zero error, like in case of a vernier caliper we did. So if the zero error was positive, it will get subtracted, because minus of plus is minus. And if the zero error was negative, it will get added, because minus of minus is plus. So this comes out to be main scale reading is 0.1. You can write it in 3 decimal place, plus circular scale reading is 0.031, and there is no zero error, so this comes out to be 0.131 centimeter. The final reading comes out to be 0.131 centimeter. Let us take few more examples. So suppose you have this particular example. In this case, you can see this part of the circular scale has crossed this reading, this reading. Okay, so what is that reading? So this was 1 mm and this is 2 mm. So we can say main scale reading is 2 mm, 2 millimeter, or 0.2 centimeter. Now circular scale division coinciding, you need to find which division is coinciding with the baseline or the reference line. So this is the reference line, and we find this division, which is the 56th division, which is in line with the main scale. So it is 56 in this case. So what is the circular scale reading? Circular scale reading comes out to be 56 into the least count, and that is 56 into, we'll write it in centimeter, 0.001 centimeter. This is 0.056 centimeter, and considering that there is no zero error, the final reading will come out to be MSR plus CSR minus zero error. So main scale reading is 0.2 and 3 decimal places, plus 0.056 minus 0. So this is 0.256 centimeter. So this is how you take reading from a screw gauge. Now, if you take the example of a wire, suppose when you place wires, the diameters of wires are very small. So this may be the case where the main scale reading will come out to be zero. You can see it has crossed this zero reading. This part has crossed the zero mark and it has not reached one. So the MSR will be 0 mm in this case, okay? Or you can say 0.000 centimeter, you can write. Similarly, circular scale division coinciding you will find. Circular scale division coinciding is again 56 in this case. You can see this particular reading I'm talking about. It is coming directly in line with the main scale. So the circular scale reading, like in this example, will come out to be 0.056 centimeter. And the final reading will be MSR plus CSR minus zero error. So this will be 0.056 centimeter. So you may have a main scale reading which is equal to zero. Especially this happens in case of finding the diameter of a wire. I hope you are clear on how to take readings from a screw gauge. In the next video, we'll be solving the numericals of exercise 1B of Concise Physics Selena publications related to screw gauge.